Yesterday, we were asked a question. Do you have advice for mission agency and church leaders preparing to send workers to the Muslim world? So there are a few things that Noreen and I have thought about and wanted to share with you. This isn't a carefully crafted talk. It's just thoughts from someone who spent 25 years working with Muslims. And I have the unique opportunity to address people like you. So as I start, I want to make a plea for a focus on the Muslim world. First of all, that it is God's time for the Muslim world. I think of the prayer movement, we talked about it yesterday, the prayer movement that was focused on me. God could have focused all that prayer on another country. He could have done it because he's the one who initiated and who drove this prayer movement. But he focused this unprecedented prayer movement on me and through me on Turkey. And why did he do this? I think it's because Turkey was the head of the Ottoman Empire. As I mentioned yesterday, it was the head of Islam. And so it's a spiritual key. There were a number of other nations that were under Turkish rule that they imposed Islam on. And so because Turkey is a key, when spiritual breakthrough comes in Turkey, I believe it will spill over to the region over which Turkey exercised spiritual control. So the prayer movement is a signal to us of what God wants to do. He chose to focus all that prayer on a key place that will then unlock the region to some degree. I'm not saying everything will become easy, but once that there's a spiritual breakthrough in Turkey, then I think it's going to lead to greater spiritual freedom in other places. And so he chose this prayer movement to focus. And there were millions of people praying. There were millions of Chinese who were praying for me. And I felt like I feel so unworthy of this. The Chinese have so many of their own prisoners. How can you be praying for me? But it wasn't about me. It was about God focusing them on Turkey and through that on that region. So my point is God was calling many people and putting that region on many people's hearts. And it's because of what he wants to do. So the prayer movement is a testimony to God's plan to move powerfully in the old Ottoman Empire, which is basically the Middle East. So let us understand the times we are living in and see that this is the time to focus on the Muslim world. Noreen and I are refocusing. We can't be in Turkey. We would love to be back there. We hope someday to be able to return. But in the meantime, we've been focusing, what does the Lord want us to do? And we were involved in leading church plants. We were involved in 6 church plants that took some kind of root, and then several others that didn't. But we think that our days of leading a day-to-day church plant are over, and now we're thinking of the next generation of church planters, how to mobilize, train, equip, help them gain access. And as we think about this, I've been thinking about this, especially about the training aspect, because I'm especially interested in the next wave of workers that go out to the Muslim world, especially to the Middle East. On my heart especially are Chinese and Brazilians. And I just talked with someone who works in Brazil, and he said there's a lot of enthusiasm, but there's a lot of attrition as well in the mission force. And my limited knowledge of Chinese missions suggests the same, a lot of attrition. The Western agencies that offer training are focusing on knowledge. That is especially what we do in the West, theological education, missions, Islamics, things like that. And I want to suggest that we need a focus. We need that as well. But we've neglected the heart many times. We've neglected the heart. I remember sitting at a table in our church in Izmir, Turkey, with a number of the Turkish men in our church, doing some kind of Bible study with them. And it just felt like the picture that came to my mind was a bunch of bulls with big horns sitting at the table, jostling each other. And there was an underlying current of competition and of envy and of pulling each other down. And I just despaired and I thought, maybe this is just the best we can do. Because I have those things in my heart. And I come from I'm a missionary kid. I was raised with a lot of advantages in that way, with blessing. I had great training. I went to Wheaton Trinity Evangelical Divinity School. I did a PhD at University of Aberdeen. So I have all this great training, at some of the best that the West can give, that the church can give. And yet I knew that in my heart, I struggled with envy. I remember my dad, who was a mission leader, telling me about this guy named Bob on their team. He said, "Bob is such a great leader. He just does everything so well. You know, Andrew, he's about your age. He studied in the same places. He's just amazing." You know what? I hated Bob. And I'd never met him, you know. So I thought, if I have these things in my heart with all of that I've received, what can I expect from my brothers who've come out of a Muslim background that has really corrupted their hearts? And I thought, I just have a real problem with deep sin in my heart. I'm deeply corrupted, and I'm just going to have to struggle against this all my life. Then I went to a conference, and there was a session on something called the orphan heart, and I thought, well, I don't need to go to that. I have great parents, you know. What is this orphan heart? And then they started to explain it, and they went down a list: competitive, envy, project-driven, wants attention, wants approval. And it just went down the list. I thought, wow, this is me. And I was 40, 42 years old. It took me this long to find out. I wish I'd found out sooner. And I found out this wasn't really at its base an issue of a corrupted heart that I have to deal with on my life. It was a matter that I had not learned to live as a son. I was living as an orphan in my responses. And there's healing for this. So there's a lot of teaching on the orphan heart and on learning how to live as a son or daughter of God. But the point is that I didn't know about it. I'd received a lot of training and didn't know about it. And this is also the reason I can be very honest and open about my weaknesses and how I was broken and many things that I would have been embarrassed about before, but I have come to be confident in the love of my Father. I'm enough of a son that I can be open about my weaknesses. So I'm sure I'm not the only one who has orphan tendencies. I know this because we've led a number of multinational teams over the years, and wherever people come from, they have many of the same heart issues. Visionaries and builders can walk all over people if they get in the way of the project. I was called Iceman by some Turks in our church, and I needed a heart change. We need to learn to forgive. We say that's automatic, but how many people have really advanced in that? We need inner healing, spiritual freedom, freedom from demonic influences. And I can tell you from experience that many workers have not gone very far in these areas. By worker, I mean missionary. And this leads to attrition on the field. It leads to blown up relationships and blown up teams. And if the worker has not had healing of the heart, how can they lead others into healthy walk with God? So we began to focus on intimacy, a heart devoted to God, because this is also what fuels endurance. It's what fuels perseverance. How do you press on in the midst of betrayals, which you're going to have a lot of in the Muslim world and in church planting? I put up with many things because of the one that I love. Because a lover is willing to suffer for his beloved. A servant is less willing. And Jesus said that the most important thing, the fundamental thing, the foundational thing, is to love God with all your heart, with all your soul, mind, and strength. We know the verses, but because this is what makes you willing to endure suffering. It's what makes you willing to press through the hardships when you're on the field. And it seems so obvious and it's so simple, yet somehow many of us still miss it. We assume that it's there in our workers. If someone's made it to the mission field, then of course they must love God. But it doesn't happen automatically. And I had to pursue, and I keep sliding. That's the natural tendency. We naturally decrease in love. We do not naturally increase. It has to be nurtured. And I have to continue to renew my pursuit. A friend of mine told me about Richard Wurmbrand, who was a Romanian pastor who suffered in communist prisons for 14 years, was tortured terribly. And he told my friend, "You know, John, I actually miss, I miss the intimacy I had with God in prison." I thought, this guy is crazy. Something's wrong with him. And I'm glad to have escaped prison. And yet, I find that there's something I miss from that terrible ordeal, because the conditions that I was in, the isolation, the threats, the fears, they drove me to cling. They were very difficult, and they tested me tremendously. But they drove me to cling to God as I never had before. And they brought a clarity about what really matters. And my everyday in prison became consumed with running after God, seeking Him, trying to draw close to Him just for spiritual survival. And now I'm free, and I'm grateful for my freedom, and I'm not under that pressure. And I miss that complete dependency. And I want to recapture that desperate seeking. So in a sense, that's what I miss from my imprisonment. And the point is that my default position is to drift. And I have to be reminded again and again to get my focus back on Jesus. So in our ministry in Turkey, what we ended up doing is refocusing with a different order of priority in everything we did. And this is how I evaluated people in our church and how I evaluate myself. We said, first of all, the first thing we need to do is focus on intimacy with God. Intimacy with Him, on the heart. Living as a son or daughter of the Heavenly Father. Learning how to hear His voice. Learning how to just spend time in His presence, soaking up His presence. Having a healed up heart, because the wounds in the heart that are not healed keep us from coming to God. They create this offense towards God, and they set up walls between us. So we said the most important thing you can have in your life is intimacy. And this is what we focus. Whatever we're doing, church planning, working with refugees, doing training, house of prayer, whatever the activity was, we said our goal is intimacy with God, seeking His presence, living His presence. Number two was character, personal holiness. Number three was knowledge. That knowledge is important, but it was number three on our list. And number four was ministry skills, gifts, and anointings. We thought we can have someone who's very skilled, someone who actually has spiritual gifts, and we don't want them in leadership if they don't have a heart after God. Because they'll mess things up. It'll be a wreck. So we started a heart school. We try to bring people through a heart school. We ran this for refugees as well. We offered, I talked with someone who was doing a lot of training in the Middle East, and we'd offered to do a heart program for some of the leaders. And he said, we've never had something like this before. All the Western groups that come over, they teach the Bible, and that's so important. But the heart is what especially matters. So I want to put that before you. Those of you who are training people to go out, training new missionaries, most of the missionaries I've seen have these problems. I include myself. We need to refocus on the heart. The second thing I want to underline is training in spiritual warfare. Is the worker prepared for the fierce spiritual warfare that they will encounter, especially if you're pioneering work? Their spiritual work, whatever your front line is, whatever your assignment is from God, you will be attacked spiritually. But there is a more intense level of warfare if you're starting new ministries. It's different. It's more intense because Satan wants to knock it out before it gets started. We went through a very difficult time. Actually, I look at our time in Turkey, and I realized it was difficult again and again and again, but we had a grace to persevere through it. But through one particular time, I was ready to give up, and the Lord just spoke a word to me, beachheads. And I started to research, what is beachheads? And, you know, in World War II, an example, you have the Marines storming an island, and the defenses are set up, and it's just a bloodbath, and people are being killed all over the place, and finally they gain a foothold in a place. And from there they can bring in reinforcements and send people out. And I thought, what we're doing when we pioneer, when we start new things, is we're establishing a beachhead in a place that the enemy has controlled. And there are going to be casualties. So there is a price to pay when you're starting new things, especially for those sending workers out to the Muslim world. It is establishing beachheads, and there is a price. Every time we started a new ministry, we got hit hard. And not just spiritually, spiritual attacks, but it can be physical, emotional, your family, your ministry. We started a house of prayer. The day we got the money to start the house of prayer, the Turkish government told us they were tearing down our condo. 6 out of 12 intercessors in the first year ended up with tumors, with head and cancer, things like that. 6 out of 12, and I thought, wait, these are the people who are supposed to cover us, and they're getting hit so hard. We started a training program, the Heart School, and our church fell apart, and every person who planned to attend had a crisis. We started a training program for Chinese in Turkey. Almost immediately, I ended up with a serious neck problem that required surgery, and of course, I ended up in prison. So anybody who speaks flippantly about spiritual warfare just has not been exposed to serious warfare. So the importance of training people for this and preparing them for this, because many missionaries from the West, it doesn't fit into their worldview. And it isn't just a matter of survival and difficult ministry. Pretty much every Muslim convert that we ever worked with had demonic issues because of their past. How are you going to set them free, bring them into spiritual freedom? How is the worker going to do that if the worker doesn't have that as part of their worldview? So this is one of the reasons there's so much attrition, is that we're not prepared. So those who are sending people out, focus on the heart and get them ready for spiritual warfare. The last thing is a plea for a focus on the basics, a return to proclamation of the gospel. I missed a connection in New York as I was going back to Turkey and ended up having to spend the whole night on the floor at JFK. And in God's plan, I think God delayed my trip so I could sit next to 3 people on their way to Turkey for training and church planting. And as we're talking, they tell me, oh, we're going to go to Turkey and we're going to spend the summer being trained for church planting. And then they told me who was doing the training. And I said, how interesting. These people have never actually planted a church. They've been trying for 20 years, but it hasn't happened yet. So if they tell you the things that didn't work, there's some value in that. But why are you going to spend a summer learning church planting from people who haven't yet done it? Nobody wants to be a traditionalist. There's something intoxicating about being on the supposed cutting edge. I found this when I was a young philosophy student at Wheaton. I became intoxicated with the power of the mind. And I just found you end up saying stupid things more intelligently. But there's this intoxication, the new way of doing things, the way that's going to be a shortcut, a key that's going to lead a large movement of people to Jesus that will help them to avoid significant persecution. And at least in Turkey, I've seen many workers come with a commitment to an ideology, to a method, and very few of them have been successful. But they have tried to spread that to everybody else in the country, that ideology. And a senior leader shared an observation with me recently. If I mentioned his name, everyone here would know him. He said he has not seen any particular mission group be successful across the board in church planting among Muslims. Instead, it tends to be individuals who see multiple church plants. So this would be an area to look into to study. It suggests to me that there's not a particular system or approach that's the magic key. And I want to point out the very basic and simple approach of Jesus, that we not lose sight of it. He modeled it for his disciples, and then he explicitly commissioned them to follow this same method, to approach things in this way. And it was proclamation and demonstration. And I'm not coming at this with any theological bent or trying to persuade anyone about a theological approach. But I want to illustrate it. I began to think about this. Lord, how did you do things, Jesus? And I began to have this conviction in my heart. We need to approach things differently in our ministry. And a woman in our church came up to me and said, Andrew, the Lord spoke to me and said, you're to go to the last bus stop at Limontepe. It's a Kurdish area of Izmir. She'd never been there. She said, at that bus stop, the last bus stop, there's going to be a cafe painted in a light color. And you're supposed to go into that place and you're supposed to proclaim healing. I thought, oh no, I don't want to do that. So I reluctantly drove my car up and found that last bus stop in that Kurdish area. And yes, there was a light-colored cafe. I thought, oh no, now I have to do this. And I went in and I said, I'm here because God sent me to proclaim healing in Jesus. Is there anyone here who needs to be healed? And long story short, I ended up going to a hospital from this. And meeting with a man named Aslan, who was in fourth stage cancer and dying in the hospital. And I said, Jesus has sent me to proclaim healing to you. And I prayed for him. And 3-4 days later, he was discharged from the hospital, and he was completely well. Now, this isn't necessarily what happens every time. But the point I want to make is when a great move of God starts, and we're looking for a great move of God in Turkey, God told us to prepare for harvest, and we've been trying to lay a foundation for that. But when a great move of God comes, it doesn't come from a technique or a method or a special approach. There are a number of factors involved. But at its foundation, it counts because there's been faithful sowing and preaching of the gospel, lifting up of Jesus, and then the Spirit of God moves in power. I give as an example Iranians. Iranians have a special grace over them right now. In Turkey, we're struggling along to have Turks come to Jesus, and there were a couple of Iranians, they wanted to start a church. I said, sure, you can use the building we're using. Within 6 months, they had filled the building. So many of them are coming. It doesn't matter how you share the gospel or who does it. It just seems like they come to Jesus so easily. There's a special grace. So the point is we need, it's the power of God. It's the move of the Holy Spirit that is really going to unlock a movement that is going to bring large numbers. So sow the seed. Lift Jesus up. Prepare for harvest. This is one of the reasons the House of Prayer movement is spreading in the Muslim world. Talked with some Chinese. I'm inviting them to come to Turkey. And they said, we're going to come, but first we're going to send the intercessors. Now, I'm not an intercessor personally. I love the intercessors. The point is, God is doing something, and there are houses of prayer that are rising up because the ground is being prepared, and there will be a great move. It will not come because of a great method we've come up with in the West in our mission schools. And those who do come into our circle, those who do become believers, we need to focus on shaping them into lovers of God, who are walking closely with him, who reflect the character of Jesus, and who are prepared to carry the power of God. So I suggest, focus on the heart. Get people ready for warfare. And preach Jesus Christ. Proclamation and demonstration. We need to go with a mindset that Holy Spirit will work through us and bring people into encounter with Jesus. And let us not forget, as workers, the most basic, fundamental, and most important thing is to nurture love for God, to hunger for God, to hunger for more of him in all that we do. I live for the day. This is how I get up every morning. I try to focus myself when I get up and say, the only thing that matters, Jesus, is what you will say about me and what you will think about me when I stand before you. I think when I stand before him, he's not going to ask me, Andrew, how many churches did you plant? How many places did you speak? How many people did you speak to? How many people did you influence? I think he's going to look at my heart response to him. Did you love me? And of course, from love comes obedience. From love comes endurance. But that's what he's looking at, is a heart response. Let us not neglect the heart. want to pray for you what I prayed for myself and my family, my children, for much of my imprisonment. Father God, I ask that you pour out on your sons and daughters the courage, the strength, the confidence, the perseverance, the endurance, and the steadfastness of Jesus, that we may run the race set before us and finish well, a beautiful bride purified in the fires of faithful obedience, tested and found worthy of her beloved, of Jesus, the King of Glory. Amen.